Good morning, everyone. Welcome back to Access to Justice class. For several weeks, we are discussing access to justice. All of you had some kind of an idea about the access to justice. So this is Dr. M.R.K. Prasad, Dean, Faculty of Law, Goa University, and Principal of V.M. Salgaonkar College of Law, Goa. Once again, we are meeting to discuss on access to justice today. However, before starting with today's lecture, I want to pose few questions to you. As you have already learned, at least to some extent, what is access to justice, just ponder upon this question: is access to justice means just providing under law an opportunity to present your case to the court? Would that be sufficient? Or it should be something else? If we say yes to the first question, we have enough laws where the provisions were made for the petitioners whenever they have any trouble to go to the court and redress their problems. In addition to the courts, we have created so many tribunals, so many enforcement mechanisms, so many quasi-judicial authorities where your grievances could be redressed. But would that be sufficient? Would it be necessary that we have some kind of a procedure to redress our grievances by approaching to the concerned authorities? If so, if we produce those procedures laid down or articulated very clearly in the legislation, would that be sufficient? If they are given so much thought about your right and the procedure, would it automatically provide you access to justice? Or should there be some other mechanism which checks or which controls these mechanisms which provide you access to justice to keep them in within their boundaries? So these are the questions that we need to think. So unlike earlier modules where we have substantially focused on the substantive law providing you right and sometimes maybe a procedure to approach various authorities for seeking justice, today's lecture we would look into how to ensure those substantial rights recognized by the law through a very, very important mechanism, that is prerogative remedies. So the prerogative remedies are very important remedies to ensure access to justice. What are we going to learn from today's lecture is the first one, as I discussed: how do we enforce the provisions of various legislations aiming at access to justice? And what we do if the enforce mechanism fail to respond? And further, what if they refuse to respond? And what happens if they abuse their power in ensuring the access to justice? And also we will look at what if they themselves hinder the access to justice. That means if the enforcement mechanism which is put by the legislation to provide you access to justice, but the enforcement mechanism themselves hinders the access to justice. For example, when you complain to a police officer, if the police officer refuses to accept your complaint, what are we going to do? How do you ensure access to justice? In such a cases, how do you seek your redressal against these authorities? Which authority to approach? How do we approach? And the most important thing is, who could approach? Means only if my complaint is refused, should I alone should go and approach the higher authority? Or on my behalf, any other person can do? So these are the questions that we are going to answer in this session. So when I said in the initial stage that we are going to talk about prerogative remedies, the meaning of the word prerogative itself shows that these are not ordinary remedies, they are special remedies. Because they are special, these remedies cannot be given by anyone. So initially the prerogative remedies were issued only by a royal authority like king. So, what are these prerogative remedies? Prerogative remedies are today known as writs. We all know that there are 5 writs that could be issued for different reasons. What is a writ? A writ is basically an order issued by a monarch exercising his or her authority of extraordinary powers under special circumstances, and they are issued to their subordinate. That means these prerogative remedies are issued by the superior to the inferior, and because it is issued by the king, they are called as royal orders. So, let us ponder a little about what is meaning of this prerogative. The prerogative means the power is exclusive domain of the crown. That means only the crown or the king, what we call, can issue these orders. And to issue those orders, you need not have any statute backing. That means there is no need for any legislation recognizing such a power to the king. King, by virtue of a king, can issue these remedies. And it is a personal power enjoyed by the king. That means it's not necessary that any other person should confer such a power to the king. It is his personal power. And the purpose of such power is to control the subordinates and other courts. That means the king can, by issuing these prerogative remedies, would able to control his subordinates and also the subordinate courts. So, therefore, we could fairly could say that these prerogative remedies have started as a kind of a discretionary power of the crown to protect their interest. However, in the modern era, these prerogative remedies are known as writ remedies. And if you look at the definition of the writ given by the Black's Law Dictionary, it says a writ is an order in the name of a state or other competent legal authority commanding the addressee to do or refrain from doing some specified act. That means if we analyze this general definition of what is writ, again the you could understand that the word crown is replaced by the state or any competent legal authority, because in a modern state now we have don't have the concept of the kings and the queens. Therefore, it's an order issued by a state or by a competent authority, mostly the courts. And why they issue? It is a commanding the addressee, that means to whom the writ is issued, asking that person to do something or not to do something is a writ. That means the writ could be issued for stopping a person from doing something, or it could be issued even compelling a person to do it. So, basically writ is an order asking a particular person to do something or not to do something. I hope that the meaning is very clear for all of you. So, let's go into how these writs were evolved or the prerogative remedies historically evolved. The origin of the writs could be attributed to the British legal system, because usually the writs are issued by the British king or queen. So, these are the writs are the results of orders passed by King's Bench in England. The writs are passed by the King's Council under the royal seal. Therefore, they are considered as a royal order. So, each writ is considered as a royal order. This prerogative power took shape due to inability of the regular court system in dealing with several disputes where the law is silent. That means, if there is a dispute between the parties and the regular law does not have any answer for that, how do we settle that dispute? So, the courts are unable to settle those disputes. So, when the law is inadequate, the people are forced to move to the king. So, therefore, the court's inability in providing a relief, we could say, to the litigants has forced them to approach the king's council, and the council exercised its extraordinary jurisdiction and issued the orders to settle those matters which subsequently popularly known as these writs. So, the writs were result of inability of the regular court system to deal with the disputes, hence the royal authority has to step in. The royal council, by exercising its extraordinary powers, issued these writ orders, and initially such writ orders are issued to protect the interest of the crown rather than the problem of the people. But later the operation was extended to the people. That means, in the beginning, in the initial stage, when the lower courts are unable to settle the dispute between the crown interest and the other interest, the crown used to issue these writs, but now it was extended even for a disputes among the citizens. So, over the passage of the time, the writs has undergone a tremendous change. The way the writs were issued, who could issue the writs, who can approach the forum to get the writs, everything has changed. But the nature of the writs did not change. They are more or less on the same grounds, the writs could be issued for the same purposes.